We'll start with, Chris Connaker from computeraudiophile.com. Chris.
As John said, I'm Chris Connaker from Computer Audiophile, and he kind of stole my thunder about being so excited about this stuff. It's just very cool. I've never been more excited about high-end audio, but I'm only 33, so, you know, so be it. I want to talk about the importance of ripping audio from CDs in terms of kind of like archiving data. When you're thinking about ripping your CDs to a computer, and you need to think about it as a whole, like come up with a strategy instead of just start throwing them in there, ripping to whatever format's the latest and greatest. Think about it kind of like a historian documenting a CD, like a slice of time for, say, future generations, because really that's going to end up being you in 3 months when your hard drive dies. So when you rip it, of course, you want to rip exactly what's on the CD. I mean, you wouldn't, like Google scanning books and getting them on the internet, you wouldn't scan the pages in yellow. You know, if you want the real book, you want the real book. So CDs, some people are trying to rip to higher bit rates than CDs. And to me, you know, just try to document the CD as a historian again. So doing that is the 16441 rip with error correction and secure rips. And secure rips are like DB PowerAmp, the program, is going to compare the rip to what everyone else is getting online. So you'll know, did I get a rip good? And then it comes down to the format, what format to rip in. It's a really serious question, because you don't want to rip 5,000 CDs again when you figure out, oh, I did it wrong. I mean, that's no fun. Your time is much more valuable than that. So what I'm starting to do now, I used to advocate ripping in AIFF format to use on my Mac because it had great metadata, album art, and everything. What I'm doing now is ripping in FLAC. All right, we're good. So I'm ripping in FLAC, and what I'm doing is creating kind of a gold copy of all my discs. And I don't play from this gold copy. It's just kind of like a vault. So I rip in FLAC, get all the metadata as perfect as possible, all the album art, and so that's my copy. Then, if I want to use it on my Mac, I convert it to AIFF. And granted, this sounds like a big process, but in the long run, it really is the way to go. So convert it to AIFF on my Mac, all the metadata is there, all the album art is there, and you know, after a while, the library gets unwieldy, and you'll lose some stuff if you have a hard drive crash. You go back to the vault, you have everything right there with all the metadata. And in terms of future proofing, it's, you know, it's impossible to future proof, but FLAC being free, a free open format, you're pretty much guaranteed you're going to be able to do something with that in the future. And you know, why not rip your file vault in Wave? Well, Wave 99% of the time for people is not going to support embedded metadata or embedded album art. It's technically possible, but it's just not a path to go down, really. And what I mean by embedded metadata and embedded album art is, if I rip a WAVE file to, say, MediaMonkey, it'll show up with album art and the track names and all that great, but you move that WAVE file to another computer and it's just a WAVE file. There's nothing associated with it. So a FLAC file, I can take one file, move it anywhere, and it still has the track name, the metadata, the album art, everything's in that file. So it's really key. Let's see here, really quick. And also as part of kind of like this gold copy vault, if you download albums, a lot of times there'll be a PDF of the liner notes, like from HD Tracks you get the PDF. I include it in the folder with the album. It's just kind of like, you know, it's my library I go back to and copy stuff out. And, you know, in the long run, your hard drive is going to die. You're going to lose data, and it's going to be so nice to go back to, like, a NAS drive that's got 2 terabytes of your music. And now, okay, do you want AIFF or do you want WAVE or what do you want? You start from there. So just 2 other thoughts real quick. Computers aren't toasters. I know everybody would like them to work like toasters. They just don't. Ferraris aren't golf carts either. So that's kind of a big one. And don't be satisfied just because you've got your computer to work and have sound. A lot of people are just happy. Oh, I got it to work. This is great. You can get much better results. Just keep at it. Read what everyone else is doing. And, you know, chances are you're going to be just as good as your CD player and possibly better. So.
Hey, thanks, Chris. Joe, you're at the other end of the whole business. Chris was talking about ripping the discs, but you're in the process of creating the bits that he's going to rip. What does the advent of the PC mean to you at your end of the business?
Well, first of all, I mean, I'm a computer moron. And if you don't believe me, Steve Silberman from Ayre and Charlie can back me up. I mean, I know how to do emails. I know how to get around a little bit. But I'm an old analog guy. I'm like a lot of people here. You know, we're dinosaurs, actually. I love analog. I think the LP is going to be with us for a long time, many years to come. Not so sure about the spinning silver disc. I think the CD's days are numbered. So this, to me, this is really exciting. It's something we should embrace. I'm living proof. If I can do it, anybody can do it. You know, there's great tutorials on the Ayre site, I'm sure on other sites that walk you through it step by step, makes it really easy for you to get your computer optimized, and you get one of these DACs, you'll be shocked. You'll really be shocked at how great it sounds. I mean, in many ways better than any CD we've ever had, and you're able to get high res. From the music standpoint, I'm really excited about the way this opens it up for a lot of us who make software. We're not dealing with physical inventory anymore, which is something that anyone who's in this business, this is a big deal. How many records do we press? How many jackets do we press? How many CD booklets? All that sort of thing. Now we're not having to deal with that. It's strictly content. So it's I think it's going to open it up to many more people to participate, which is always great. It also, finally, you can hear master tapes, whether it's new content or older material. Obviously, I love the old jazz records and new jazz records. But you're able to hear it the way it was really meant to be heard. You can hear what's on that master tape. So to me, it's something we should really seriously embrace. A few months ago, I was in Munich at the Munich Hi-Fi Show, and it was amazing to see how strong a presence computer audio was there. And you know, you notice when you're there, the demographic is quite different. Younger, much younger demographic than the hi-fi shows. I'm not saying we're all old, but come on, look around. And you know, younger people, they grew up with computers. I mean, they're used to this. This is how they relate to music. This is how they get their music. So it's something that if we don't embrace and if we don't participate in it, we're at risk of this business dying. So it's really something to participate in. I think you're going to see a lot of, I'm working on a number of deals right now. I hope to announce them here, but not quite yet, for high resolution downloads. But it's if I can do it, anybody can do it, and you should all participate in it.
Okay. Thanks, Joe.
Charlie.
So we've heard from the two opposite ends of the chain. The next three speakers are going to address what happens in the middle, getting the bits out of the computer and into the system. So first, Charlie Hansen from Ayre. Is that as easy as it sounds?
No, it's not. The whole computer audio thing has kind of been this thing that's been gaining momentum, and it's been kind of a you know, several different factors have all been converging at once, and now it's reached a critical mass where it's gonna take over. And so, you know, one of the things was the fact that when they made the CD, nobody could copy it. It was just like an LP. Like, nobody can copy an LP. I mean, you could buy a cassette recorder and make an inferior copy of it, but you couldn't copy the original thing. And then, you know, because the CD was designed for audio, and it was only about 5 years later that someone said, hey, there's a lot of data storage on here. We could use this for computers. And they went back and they rewrote the spec and they adapted it for computers. And that kind of like was the crack, you know, that burst the dam, because, you know, when they first made CD burners, like the first one, I think Pioneer, it was $2,000. So you didn't have a lot of people buying them, you know. And then they got down to 500, and then a lot of people were buying them. And then when they got down to 100, then everyone was buying them. And now all of a sudden, you know, you can copy a CD. And so, of course, that had a huge impact on the record industry, you know, because now people could copy them. And then right about that same time that that was happening, they did work on the compression formats. And so they could take the music and throw away 90% of the data and still get sound that was acceptable to not the people in this room, but to the normal people. Because we're not that normal. So that was the MP3, and that hit about the same time. So the MP3 was, you know, you, by throwing away 90% of the data, now you had a file that was small enough that you could share on the internet, and that was the whole Napster thing. And so like that happened, and then another thing happened at the same time, which was that the patents on the CD expired. So prior to that, Sony and Philips had the patents on CD. And between the royalties on the hardware and the royalties on the software, so the royalty on a CD, I'm told, and Joe can probably verify this, I'm told was 7 cents a disc for a CD. But that amounted to literally $1 billion a year for Sony and Philips. That was just like free money. So like, even when you're like Sony, like at their peak, like I don't know what they are now, but at the peak they were like a $10 billion a year company. Well, to have 10% of your money coming in for free, like that really makes a big difference on your bottom line if you ever run a business. Like that's a big deal, $1 billion a year. So when that patent those patents expired, that's what really had them go out and try and invent these new formats, you know, DVD audio and super audio CD. It wasn't really so much that they thought, hey, what the world really needs is, you know, something better. It was like they're going, holy crap, what are we going to do? That $1 billion a year is going away. And so let's figure out some other way that we can replace that. And what they were thinking that was going to induce everyone to buy into that was surround sound. They thought that, you know, like home theater was doing surround sound and like everyone was going to have like, you know, five blah, 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 and all that stuff. And of course, that didn't happen. Most people don't want to listen to music in surround sound. It's just too much trouble. But that what did happen out of all that, and this really came out of the MP3. So again, all these factors were kind of all swirling around and it converged, was that, you know, you had the iPod. And so there was a few years where everything was like very murky and no one knew what was going to happen. And then what came out of that and clarified and solidified and made the whole thing gel was Apple. Steve Jobs cut a deal with all the record companies and formed the iTunes store, you know, and now you can buy a song for 99 cents. And that's how most young people buy their music. So now we've really got all these forces pushing you in the direction of a computer, because if you've got an iPod, you can't put the music on the iPod without first putting it on your computer. And if the music's on your computer, like, it's kind of silly if you want to listen to it at home to put it on the iPod and then put it back into your stereo. Just listen to it straight from the computer. And so I was really kind of interested in all that, and I called up a friend of mine who's really a brilliant engineer, done a lot of work with RF and high-speed analog, and did audio work on the side. And I called him up and I said, "Hey, Pat," this was about, I don't know, 2-3 years ago. I said, "Pat, you know, like this computer audio thing, like, you know, something's happening here, and I want to get involved in it. And like, what should I do?" And he's like, "Oh, well, I don't know anything about it, but you know who you need to talk to is Gordon Rankin, because Gordon Rankin was like, got the, he's working on this thing that's really amazing." And so I said, "Really?" So I didn't even call him. I'm an email guy. I'm in a wheelchair now. I had an accident 3 years ago, and I just get on my computer and I email, and I said, "You know, like Pat said that you know about computer audio." So he has been working on this thing to get the data out of your computer in a way that has less jitter than any other method of digital audio transmission in the history of audio. You know, because normally we had this thing where if you had a transport and a DAC, they were connected by a link called SPDIF, which was Sony Philips Digital Interface Format. And that inherently adds jitter. And so it's not something that I'm really interested in, because I'm interested in getting the best performance. And so Gordon said, "I'm working on this way where we can get the data without the jitter, where the DAC's going to have the clock in it, and the DAC's going to be in charge." And I said, "Sign me up." I said, "What do you need from me? How can I help?" And there wasn't really much I could do, except every once in a while I got out the cattle prod, because he'd go, I'm really busy. I just got an order, and I've got to build these things." And I'm like, "Gordon," I said, "yeah, you got to get it done." And then he'd go like, "Well, I got it working on the Mac." And I'm like, "Gordon, that's only 10% of our customers." He goes, "Well, just tell them to buy a Mac." And I'm going like, I'm like, "Well, some of them will listen to me if I tell them that, but I don't think all of them will." So anyway, Gordon stuck with it. And so we licensed this technology. He calls it Wave Stream. Streamlength, I'm sorry, Streamlength. Wavelength is the company, Streamlength is the technology. And it's a way to get, so there's a lot of different ways to get the computer, the data out of your computer and into your stereo system. And, you know, there's a lot of different companies that make a lot of different machines to do that. And the way that we've chosen is to follow in the footsteps of Gordon and use the USB port and use this special software where the DAC sends commands to the computer telling it, "I need more data now, send me some data," and then it stores it in the buffer, and it's clocked out of that local buffer in the DAC by the low jitter clock that's right there in the DAC. So I'm going to stop talking now and pass it on.
Pass it on to Gordon. I mean, Gordon, why USB? Why not Ethernet? Why not FireWire?
Because I didn't have to write the drivers. I, coming from a computer industry where I wrote drivers for a living for years, I felt that was the wrong way to go. I needed to find some way where I didn't have to introduce drivers for any particular operating system, that we could use the technology that was already available and get the most out of it. And that's really what we're trying to do. And
can you use your mic, please?
Oh, sorry. So what I did was I said, I looked at all the technologies available, and USB had this backdoor, this asynchronous technology that gives you this vehicle to do just what we wanted to do, and all the operating systems already had that embedded technology in it. And I worked with Apple and Microsoft and verified that, you know, we got everything correct. You know, we came out with this technology. But the one thing I want to hit on real quick is, and John Atkinson brought this up earlier, with the demise of DVD-A and SACDs,
I think we now have a real way of going high resolution. And I think the record companies are starting to come on board. You know, they're already creating master files, then they're dropping those to 4416, and they're dropping those to MP3. You know, I've been talking to a lot of recording engineers, and I say, look, you know, you should release it just like that. Everybody here in high-end audio wants the highest resolution. But these companies can still make a ton of money off the MP3s, which will also pay for our addiction. And I think that the great thing about this is computer audio is going to give us this vehicle, and we won't be stuck in a format war because of it. And with that,
I'm going to pass it on. Okay, thanks. John. Yes, so John Stronczer from Bell Canto. Your company has been involved in making traditional digital products, transports, DACs. How do you then enter this brave new world?
Yeah, good question. We actually implemented a USB link for similar reasons, because USB is supported in the native drivers in both Windows and the Mac platform, which is an advantage for numerous reasons. For me, there are three critical areas to be worried about in transporting digital from the computer to the DAC or to the audio system: is bit perfect transfer, and the native drivers achieve that. Some of the other drivers do weird things. Bit perfect, low jitter, or zero jitter in the case of the asynchronous approach, an excellent approach for that for a USB port. And galvanic isolation. In other words, I don't want my audio system connected galvanically through the ground or power to the computer system. So our approach from the beginning, and it's been about 3 years, we actually implemented our first USB port, which was admittedly, it's definitely long in the tooth today, the original port in the DAC 3. The jitter level was too high. We couldn't suppress it enough. But the new device we have has much lower jitter, akin to a SPDIF port, which still isn't low enough. And how we address the jitter problem is with a very aggressive filter inside of the D2A converter, yes, to ensure that the local clock is clean enough for the conversion, the high dynamic range conversion. And let's see. Oh, I just wanted to relate a very quick anecdote. I lent a friend of my daughter's, an 18-year-old guy who's into music. He's a musician. His dad's a recording engineer. He's got all of his music in full resolution on his Apple computer. I lent him one of our little integrated units, and he hooked it up to a pair of cheap speakers he got free, early 80s costs, believe it or not. And the kid, I heard it, and it's amazingly good. And he sent me an email a day or two after saying how he's rediscovering his music. This is the future. These are all the new audio files. They're going to be on the computer.
Yeah. Gus, your thoughts.
Well, I come from a different side of the business. I've been involved with professional audio going way back, actually back to when the CD started, but for about 20 years I've been working on computer-based recording equipment. Some of it, more lately we've had to make our own. About 10 years ago I started working with the Super Audio Group within Sony, and my job was to make it easy for people to make masters for Super Audio and support, the efforts in making those masters. But, one thing that was kind of clear right away was, okay, this is a great format, but there's nothing really out there that can make music of the quality that can really play. Everything these days is being done in computer and in PCM, but that's not, where this machine excels. Sony, kind of, in the back rooms in the engineering departments, came up with this format that they don't talk much about, and it's called DSD Disc. Another company, Korg, has been working with them on this. It's not a secret, but there's plenty of stuff. There's some Sony gear that can play these discs. They don't tell you about it. For example, every PlayStation 3 can play a DSD disc in DSD. So if you listen out the analog port on the PlayStation 3 and you put in one of these discs, you hear pure DSD.
Does that include the new ones?
Yes.
Won't play SACD.
They don't play SACD. The reason they don't play SACD is because early on they took a processor out, and that was doing the lossless compression. So once that left, they didn't want to spend the money on
processing for lossless compression. This doesn't use compression. It's not protected. It's an open format. It's kind of big right now with the taper community that'll go to shows and, you know, tape live dead shows and that kind of thing. They use this little Korg device, and they tape it. They share it with their friends over the internet. The other nice thing about this is that this disc, you could make it a disc image. You could compress it with standard compression tools and maybe get about 30%, with just the normal computer compression tools. And you can distribute it over the internet. On the other end, they take, you know, the image file, they make a disc, they stick it in their PS3, and they hear DSD. And I know maybe the PS3 isn't the best audiophile unit to listen to music on. It's actually not too shabby. But the good thing is that young people can hear what music can really be like. And I think that's important. I think the more people are exposed to what music can be like, you know, I'm going to put some pressure on the record companies, and maybe things will improve. And hold on a sec. This, about the size of an iPod, will play these DSD files. And can I play something? Joe, I ripped some of your music.
Yeah, please.
Just, oops.
This here from the last show. But just to give you an idea of what this sounds like, this DSD on this little portal.
Excellent. Thank you, guys. So it's who was that, Joe?
Mighty Sam.
It's Mighty Sam. Nice stuff. So we've examined the subject from the front end, through the middle, to the sharp end, from the sharp end to the very playback end. Does any of the other panelists have anything they want to say before we open it to the questions from the audience? Yeah, okay, so who has a question which is going to put these guys on the spot? You sit at the back. Please speak up.
Pretty naive. What's the bit rate of Red Book CD?
It's like
1,411.
Yeah,
1,411
bits per second.
1,411
kilobits
per second.
1.4 megabits per second.
Yeah.
You sort of back?
What do you think the chances are, really, that the record labels, the larger ones, managing normal artists, are willing to let higher resolution tracks out in unprotected formats be used by players like this?
I don't know. I mean, I was at a private audition of the new Beatles remasters back in June. And so we listened to the discs, and they sounded pretty good. And I turned to Alan Rouse, who was in charge of a project, and I said, so you did all the new transfers at 192K with 24-bit resolution. I said, what are you going to let them, you know, be available as downloads? And at that moment, an Apple PR person stepped in and said, please don't ask that question. And I said, well, okay, how about releasing the high-res Beatles stuff on SACD? And he said, please don't ask that question. We're only here to talk about CDs. Okay, well, and I wonder if the record industry, Joe, you should step in on this, really doesn't know what they have.
Well, I can speak a little bit to it because I'm involved in something right now, but unprotected, I doubt it, unprotected. High res, yes.
But my whole point from the very beginning with it's unprotected, it's open format, it becomes divergent and it opens the world open to anything that can be done.
True.
And that it creates excitement for you guys and for audiophiles. It's like...
No, I would love, personally, I'd love to see it. And, you know, when Gus emailed all of us a week ago, I mean, everyone on this panel got very excited about what he was talking about. The major labels, you know, they continue to be paranoid about copying. So if there was a way to do some kind of protection that, or encryption that didn't mess things up, and I don't know the answer. We're doing tests right now.
Yeah. But has anybody here read Chris Anderson's book, Free? Which he goes into this into some detail about that all attempts to protect what you're doing basically are doomed to failure. The thing is, make it available, live with the consequences, and work out how to make money from it. At the back,
John Roque.
Jan Mancuso.
Hi. I think maybe part of the answer about open format tools from the major labels is that they're gonna, I think, take a major artist, somebody like U2 or The Dead or somebody who says, I'm not buying into that crap, or Bruce Springsteen, I want it to be unprotected, or someone has to come up with a protection device, like you said, that will suit the lawyers.
Another question. Oh, Gordon, you had something to say?
Okay, the reason SACD and DVD failed was because of copy protection. You know, these guys need to wake up. You know, if they want it to fail again, it will fail. And as John said, you know, we just have to open this up. And the thing that the big companies have to realize is that the people, us, you know, that want the high resolution are not the ones that are going to be copying it and giving it to all our friends. You know, we are not the ones that are the problem. The MP3s are the ones that are getting passed around. So I think that they just need to wake up.
But Chris, isn't there also a problem on the front end in that most high-res stuff you can download is in the form of FLAC, but iTunes won't play FLAC files, not without some utility, not without some pain on the part of the user. Mm-hmm. Is that going to change?
Not anytime soon.
Why? Impossible.
Well, the problem with
the problem with offering something other than FLAC or something compressed on a download is bandwidth. Bandwidth right now is pretty expensive. So everyone's just looking to save money. And, you know, a lot of people's internet connection is much faster now. So I hope the people offering the content won't use that excuse anymore. You know, if people want to download it and they wait half an hour or 6 hours, hey, if you can get it in your listening chair, perfect. So I think bandwidth is the only problem.
Okay. We have a question right at the back.
Yeah, it's not so much a question, it's more of a statement. I think that in some respects, the music industry is starting to become aware of this because of the results of reaction to things like the don't pay as much as you think it's worth download in rainbows from Radiohead has made quite a difference. This has created ripples in the pool. A lot of music companies at the moment are struggling because their model of making money doesn't work anymore. It doesn't work in today's downloaded world. So in some respects, companies are looking as being, instead of being just a record company, they're looking at being a music providing company, providing a lot of meta music. They're providing the show information, the band is a touring vehicle, is everything. This is all what they're providing. And in many respects, the music content is almost, at that point, almost irrelevant.
Yeah, Chris Anderson's book Free uses Be in Rainbows as an example, but the music industry reached a tipping point in 2001. There was an industry conference in Sun Valley, Idaho, where they met with the founders of Napster, and the idea was to work out what they were going to do in the future, because as Chris Anderson says in Free, the future's going to happen anyway. All you can do is go along with it and work out, come up with some kind of business model which will function. And in 2001, the record industry en masse decided no, they were not going to go with Napster. They were going to take a more aggressive
attitude towards file sharing and copying, which then was in its infancy, and rely on their current business model to make money. They turn their back on the future, and now the result is that, you know, they're losing their shirts. Their business model doesn't work anymore. And as I said, they're slow so far to get into the new model offered by downloads and by computerized music.
I think he's right, though, that there's been such a perfect storm, if you will, that's hit them. That, I mean, it's down to rock bottom. I mean, the people I deal with at EMI are all 20-somethings, 30-somethings. The people that have been there a long time are gone.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So the attitude, you know, it's not like 2 or 3 years ago when, you know, you thought, God, wake up, you dinosaurs. The dinosaurs are gone for the most part. And so they are willing to consider things that there was no way they would look at a few years ago because, you know, their whole model has been shattered. And thank God. You know.
Yeah. One thing.
Sure.
I just want to add on to that. Like, one of our customers is Rick Rubin. I don't know how many people have heard of Rick Rubin, but he's a big producer of records. He started Def Jam Records to do rap music. This is how he got started. And so that became huge. And then he started working for Sony, which was the establishment. And then he started doing like the series with Johnny Cash and stuff. And so he right now is about one of the only guys that knows how to make money at the big labels. But even those guys are having trouble figuring out. So for example, there's about 2 or 3 guys that work under him. So like he works with like the very, very top tier artists. And then like there'll be someone that works under him, like but we were talking to one of them and he said, like, I just did this record with Maroon 5 or something. It was some band like that that, you know, you've heard of, and like they sell a lot. And he goes, like, and it's a royalty deal basis, which is the normal thing, and like I made $6,000 so far. And he goes, I spent 3 months on that, you know, and I got a family to feed. And he says, like, it's just not working. And so they're trying to figure out, like, you know, because the problem is with the downloads, like it used to be you'd hear a song on the radio and you'd go, oh, that's a great song, I'll go buy that album. And you'd go buy that album, and it was, you know, in the old days it was $7.99 for the LP, and then when they came out with the CD, then all of a sudden it's $15.99. But you'd go out and you'd buy it, and then the record companies would make money. But now you hear that song on the radio, go, oh, I'll buy that, and it's 99 cents. And the volume of money being transacted is so much smaller because you can just cherry pick the songs you want. And that's, I think, one of the main things that they're really, really struggling with right now is trying to figure out how can we, because it's not like people have stopped listening to music. It's not like, oh, yeah, music, yeah, that's old hat. No one listens to music anymore. No, people listen to music and people buy music. It's just that they just buy a song at a time instead of an album at a time, and they still haven't figured out how to make that all work. So we're still in that transition, but the computer's part of that transition.
Yeah, music. There are 3 renewable pleasures in life: food, sex, and music. And so anything associated with those is going to succeed. We've got a little bit of time left. I just wanted to ask the panelists about the elephant in the room that somebody referred to in passing, but we haven't discussed at all, which is the intermediary between the music and the hardware and our hi-fi systems are the computer companies themselves and their operating systems. I don't know how many of you have had experience wrestling with XP or with Vista or with Mac OS, trying to make sure what comes out of the USB port to Gordon's DAC or whatever are the bits that are on the file. It's not trivial. I mean, Chris, is there an easy resource, go-to resource, where you can look up what your computer is and say, I have to do this?
There's no easy resource. Of course, I could say, yeah, visit my site. You know, you'll figure it out. But there isn't, and it's like I said, computers aren't toasters. It can be a nightmare. I think one of the cool things about Mac OS, though, is it's very, very simple. you don't have much to do to get bit perfect audio. And I use Macs and PCs. You can get great sound out of both. But you know, I think long term, the best, the thing with the most possibilities is a Linux platform. There's a few people here at the show that are running Linux. They're not calling a music server. Some are, some aren't. But a Linux open source platform where you can pare down the operating system any way you want and just run what it takes to get audio out of there. You can write your own drivers to the audio card. And I know that this may, it may sound like, you know, rocket science or whatever if you just want the toaster. In the end, it does equal the toaster. So Linux long term has the biggest possibilities.
Okay, we got like a few minutes. I'd like to ask each of the panelists to give like a 2-minute summation. Gus, would you like to start? What is the future going to hold, Gus?
Well, you know, I've been at this DSD thing for like 10 years now, and I am totally sold. It's just a completely different character to listening to, you know, PCM music, and I'm spending all my time right now trying to make this happen and get exposure of what the potential is. A lot of you guys know because you're audiophiles, but so many kids out there have never heard DSD or what it can sound like. Even when they go to shows, you know, everything goes through PCM mixer at a live show, so they don't know analog other than maybe hearing someone sing live with an acoustic guitar, no sound reinforcement system. So this one, my friend, I've been working with David Elias. We did the first hybrid multi-channel SACD several years ago for an independent artist. He can't afford to make an SACD now, so he's going to distribute it like this on the internet. So this is The Window by David Elias, and if anybody has a PS3 and would like one of these, just come on up, and I have a few of them.
Can I make a quick comment on that DSD open format? How does someone who's younger that is due to iTunes, how do they get that file? How do they hear about it, find out about it, and how will they listen to that? They don't know about it.
Well, yeah, that's a big problem. You know, Sony is not marketing this at all. It's, even if you look at the equipment, it's not even in the specs. It's a secret right now. But the tapers, you know, there are young kids who are going to shows. They know about it because, you know, their friends are using these little cords and recording shows. It's a very small part. Yes, exactly. It's up to us to make it happen. And John, and word has to get out.
Yeah.
But you know, when you hear this stuff, you fall in love with it and you want to hear more.
John Johnson.
See, I've had an iMac sitting in my main listening room for over 3 years, operating 24 hours a day, 365 days a week, and it works great. It's after living with it, I can't imagine living without a computer as an alternate source of music. I still have a turntable and a CD player also, but you know, there's no question that the computer is going to be the future of the audio experience. It just opens up a whole new world of possibility, just like what Gus is talking about, and other things that we don't even know about. That's about it.
Okay, Gordon.
So what's coming?
Tubes?
Yeah. Everything should be done with tubes. No. I think the big thing is the next step is 24, 32, 192, you know, 384, you know, high speed USB. There's just going to be a lot more of that coming out in the very near future. But the one big problem is Windows will only support 2496 right now, but Mac OS X will support up to 64, 384, something like that now. So.
Also, get a Mac. As a manufacturer, we don't want to be answering Windows questions all day.
and I would have to disagree with Chris on the Linux stuff.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. You know, unless you want to learn all those Unix commands, a total geek.
Expert.
Yes.
Is it going to be easier in Windows 7, Gordon?
Or call Chris. Just have him set up your Linux.
I think they just renamed it, didn't they?
Charlie.
I think what they've been touching on is what's really exciting about the computer is that it is an open format. So unlike a CD player that only plays 4416, you know, the computer can play whatever you want it to play, and you just have to write the software. And so, for example, we just learned about this thing, this DSD disk, last week. I'd never heard of it. And we were assembling the panel, and we were sending out the emails, and Gus said, oh, DSD disk. And I'm like, well, what the hell is that? And he's like, well, it's this. And like, so I'm like, hey, Gordon, like, can we, because, so inside our DAC, we've already got the DAC chip that handles DSD. And then in our particular DAC, there's a thing in there that's called an FPGA, a field programmable gate array. So we can reprogram that. So if we write the software and packetize the DSD information, we can send it across the USB link and play it on our DAC. And so you could download this file and have it on your computer and play it back on your DAC. So there's a few steps we got to work out. It's not going to happen like tomorrow, but this is something that's going to be happening. So like right now, like there's hdtracks.com that's started by the Chesky brothers, and they have close to 1,000 titles right now available in 2496. And so you can download high resolution music now. And that's just going to continue. You know, we're going to see it get higher and higher, you know, 192, you know, or this DSD disk. And, you know, we want to have that so that will be the future of high resolution music. So we don't have to be constrained by what these giant corporations, you know, hand down as edicts. Well, this is the format, 4416, you know. So, and then the other thing, of course, is the convenience, because, you know, when you put all of your music onto one place and you can browse it by however you want, by title, by artist, by genre, by put it on random, you know, put it on random by genre, put it on random by artists that start with A, you know, whatever you want to do, you know, you can do it. So it's just really exciting, you know. It's an exciting time, and it's an exciting time to open it up to younger people too, because that's how they've been used to dealing with music.
Yeah, Chris, I'll jump past Joe. I want to come back to Joe.
Okay, I'll respond to John and Gordon here. don't go out and buy Linux thinking you're going to make the greatest music server out of it, because it's an absolute disaster if you're not, you know, if you don't know computer science. But long term, the people that know Linux will be able to make servers for everybody that work like a toaster. You'll use your iPhone. You won't have to worry about the operating system. Short term, Mac OS, Windows, you know, easy. So, yeah, like everyone else, so excited about this stuff. It's awesome. It's here now. You can really do it and get a computer up and running, get it going, get music going as a start, and then don't be satisfied just because you have music. You can take it far beyond what your CD player is capable for most everybody.
And final word from you, Joe, because you represent the music making community, and you know, there are new markets opening for you.
Well, incredibly exciting, because anything that allows you to hear exactly what we recorded, whether it's an original recording or a remaster, is better. I mean, it's good for all of us. We want to hear the music that way, and it's good for our business, because when resolution is higher, you know, you're more drawn in to the experience. It's much harder to sit there and, you know, pick up the paper and do the dishes, whatever. You tend to relax and let yourself just get into it. So anything that allows us to hear exactly what was recorded, the way it was supposed to be heard, is exciting. And again, like everyone's saying, I would embrace it now, because it's here. It's the way people are going to be listening to music. Still by LPs, though. I think, you know.
Well,
there's nothing wrong with that.
Okay. Thank you, panelists. Thank you, audience. And have a great show. Thank you.